Today is a challenging topic for me. I struggle with talking about humility and with pride because there's no one of us that are human, which I'm assuming is everybody here. There's a few that I wonder about sometimes, but generally, that's probably just the hopeful Star Trek fan in me. But generally, I recognize that we all struggle to be humble people. And I think that pride is an epidemic that has existed since the dawn of the fall to today, and I'm sure will continue to be a plague on humanity until Christ returns. St. Augustine said, "Should you ask me what is the first thing in religion, I would reply, the first, second, and third thing therein is humility." Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6. It's going to be kind of our key verse for today. And I think this verse really does a great job just summing up for us how the Lord desires for us to live. And it says, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that He may exalt you in due time." We want to be exalted ourselves. We want to exalt ourselves. We want people to notice us. We want people to feel that we're valuable, that we have something important to share with the group and in the situation. And so that pride wells up and it stirs in within us our sin nature and our desire to be noticed, to be in the spotlight, to be somebody, to be something important. And our culture affirms this. It encourages us towards that. I mean, if you every commercial, almost without fail, it appeals to you and what you deserve or what you need. And it puts the emphasis on ourselves. And so we are surrounded by an environment of people that are self-centered, that are thinking about and that are focused upon those things that draw out the worst in our nature. And it's very hard, it is very, very hard to be a humble person. It is very hard to reflect this verse in 1 Peter in our culture. I believe this is why, and as I've tried to learn a bit about the Amish and Mennonite cultures, why they live the way they do. You know, I think that some of us perceive them a little bit snobbish, and we think that they think that they're better than us, and that they're anti-technology, that they're against, having technology or material things that make life comfortable, when in fact, their goal is to fulfill Scripture. Their goal is to be considered the least of these. And so they're not against technology, they're not against having things necessarily, it's that they feel that they need to have less than what we have generally in culture. So that's why it's constantly changing in the world. I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but for example, when I was growing up, you didn't see the multicolored outfits that the ladies wore. You know, they always wore certain colors. They're usually fairly drab, maybe a muted color or a dark color. And now you see blue and pink and, you know, Walmart's probably the only place I typically see a lot of them. I got to meet a Mennonite gentleman when I was at the lumber store down here in south of Ozark the other day. But you'll notice that now they can do that. And why is that? It's because as our standard of living increases, then the lowest standard of what people have is growing. That's why, you know, used to they couldn't have phones in their home, but now they can. Why? Because we have cell phones. See, so I hope you understand that and I'm sure that if we had an Amish or Mennonite person here, they could explain it better than I could, because I'm certainly an outsider looking in trying to understand and explain their subculture. But I think that they model a good thing for us, and is that we ought to consider ourselves the least of these. And we'll talk some more about that in a minute. Matthew 23:12, and I'm going to be going through a number of scriptures today, so if you don't have time to look all these up, that's fine. I've got the important ones that will be up on the screens, and not that one of them is more important, but some of them are more directly applicable to the topic. But I want to note this verse, Matthew 23:12, which says, "Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted." See, there is a fruit of pride. There's a fruit that is born out of pride, and there's a fruit that is born out of humility. And when we humble ourselves, when we bring ourselves low, then we are bringing to ourselves good fruit. We're planting things that will grow and will be good and healthy in our life and healthy to the people that are around us. But when we plant seeds of pride, we're planting seeds of hate and anger and discord and selfishness that hurt us and everyone around us. And so there is a fruit. And we'll look at several examples. I think one of those we see is in the scriptures with Lucifer. I mean, if you look at the main problem there, it's that Lucifer had a pride problem. He thought that he could rule heaven better than God. He or perhaps not necessarily better, but he just wanted to. He felt like somehow it was his right, or he was destined to do that. And so he rebelled against God, and it created a wave of catastrophe and pain and suffering that we are all a part of. And so I think that's a good example. Another example is Adolf Hitler in Germany in the 1930s. He began to believe and began to tell others that his race was superior, that his culture was superior, and that other particular cultures were lesser or inferior. And so he began to brainwash people and teach that, and more and more people believed that. And then we not only had the atrocity of millions of Jews being persecuted and killed, but millions of other people fighting in a worldwide war that were killed, and it just caused great catastrophe and disaster. Another example, I think back to the Old Testament, to Ahaz, who was the king in Judah, who just repeatedly refused to humble himself before God. He had set up the Asherah poles, and he worshipped Baal. He worshipped a lot of the pagan gods that the Samaritans and other of the nations that, of course, many of them had been part of Israel prior, that had now forgotten God, and they had begun to worship these idols, and they set up these shrines of immorality all over the place. And God repeatedly sent these prophets, and a lot of the prophets we have, like Amos and Isaiah and others, that he sent to cause him to repent, and he just refused. He just would not humble himself. And so the Assyrians just came and wiped out Judah. I mean, just wiped them out and drug everyone off into slavery. And in all three of these cases, with Lucifer, with Hitler, with Ahaz, the damage that was done was on a massive scale that affected millions of people. But yet it just was one being who didn't humble themselves, that allowed pride to reign in their life, that caused all of that damage, all of that pain and suffering. And so I start out with that today so that you realize the significance of being a humble person, of being a person that walks gently and cautiously in the world around you. You know, there's nothing worse than an arrogant young person. I know this because I can see myself as an arrogant young person in many senses. You're always thinking, when I was a teenager especially, that I knew everything, that I knew how to do something, that I could figure it out. And I constantly created problems for myself and others in that, and can look back now, and I'm sure that I will be able to look back 20 or 30 years from now and see that about myself right now. And so I hope that as each of us look at our lives, that we can begin to not be blinded by our pride, but to see the areas that we need to change in. Because I would say, and this is my speculation, my opinion, but I would say this is the area that as Christians in general, this is the area we need the most improvement in. Because we're so selfish, we're so prideful and arrogant, thinking that we know everything, thinking that our way is the best way, demanding verbally, demanding by manipulating people that we should have things a certain way. And the way that we see the world is the right way, and we fail to keep an open mind, and we fail to humble ourselves and to recognize the value of putting others first and us being last. All right, turn with me, please, to Deuteronomy chapter 8, and let's look here a little bit. We need to answer the question, how do we be humble? How do we, or if we have come to a place of humility, how do we stay in that place? How do we live a life of humility? All right, and I hope in talking to this point, I've defined that term. Being humble really simply just means to let our desires, our self, our wants, to become less important than the needs and desires of other people. All right, if you're looking for that definition, those more analytical of us, they're kind of waiting with that humility dash, waiting for me to define that, as I tend to do that because that's my speaking and personality style. I try to vary that for the more creative types. That is what we're talking about when we say that word humility or being humble. Deuteronomy 8, chapter 2 says, "And you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not." All right, so let's just rewind. We mentioned Ahaz before, during the time of the reign of the kings following David, you know, up from David up to the point of the time before Christ. Now we're going to reverse the clock and go way back in time to the point that Israel had wandered in the wilderness after being led out of slavery in Egypt. They had exited that and they were getting ready to enter the promised land, and God is working in them and he's warning them. This is a warning. A warning that was not heeded by the majority of Israel and Judah's kings. He was warning them to humble themselves and that he was going to test them to know whether that they would keep his commandments or not. And he said, remember your journey through the wilderness. You know, I'm not quite 40 years old yet. I just turned 34 this last Thursday. And so I can't even imagine yet, well, I can imagine, but I don't know yet what it means to live 40 years. But I can imagine that if I had wandered in a wilderness being a nomad for 40 years, I would learn some kind of a lesson from that. I would take something away. I would be humbled. I would realize that my recklessness, my arrogance was disaster-causing behavior. And that I think that God is trying to underscore this in those people that endured that, that lived through that, many of whom were very young. I mean, most of the people that started in the wilderness, well, all of the people that started in the wilderness had died off, all right? And so you only have the people that were born into that and that lived that. So you got these people that are 40 years old, maybe a little younger, that are coming out and God is warning them, saying, remain humble. Remember where you've come from. Because what you have to remember about this time, that there was no reason for the Israelites to go through that time in the wilderness. They chose that for themselves because they refused to trust God. They refused to have faith in him. They believed that their own ability to size up the situation was greater than God's ability. And as a result of that, they wasted 40 years and over a generation of people accomplishing nothing and living in a life of hardship and difficulty. And so they brought that on themselves. And so God is saying, don't waste that. Don't waste that pain. Don't waste that time in the wilderness. Remember that time. Humble yourself before the Lord. But of course, they failed to do that. Proverbs 15:1 says, "A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger." You know, if you ever, you know, it's sometimes I think, you know, it would be good, not really, but it would be a good teaching tool if you could, you know, have a little observation window into the house family, because you could see some of these things being played out. When I was in elementary school, I went to a private elementary school, and they had these observation rooms, which it was just normal to me. Now I feel like really violated, you know, like people were watching me all the time. But it was for college students that would just view teachers in the classroom. They would view behavior of students in the classroom, and so, you know, it was a good thing. I'm sure it's a helpful thing, is teachers can go and kind of watch that and not be a distraction to the class, because, you know, when kids are always distracted by new people in the classroom, so it was a way for that to happen without it being a distraction. But, you know, sometimes I think our family needs that observation tool, because we could probably model, you know, some of these things of what not to do and how this works out. But in our household, and I would suspect in yours as well, this verse plays out very well. That we fail to give a soft answer when we respond to some kind of bickering or accusation or something, and we give a harsh answer. And then that person retaliates in a harsher answer, and then the other person retaliates, and then in our case, since we have multiple people, other brothers and sisters get involved, and it just becomes a great calamity of chaos. And that is what happens when we fail to humble ourselves. See, all of those harsh words, all of those things shouted or spoken in anger, that is the symptom of a greater problem, of a pride problem. Because we think that we deserve for our voice to be heard. We make that demand that we be heard, that our statement be made, except we have to kind of up the ante every time we do that. And that's why Solomon, in his wisdom, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, writes, a soft answer turns away wrath. See, how do you battle anger and hatred and fighting? With soft speech, with a gentle heart, with a humble heart. That's how you battle that. Not with a louder voice. Not with a bigger stick. I mean, look how that's played out in life. We have so many nuclear weapons now that we could destroy the Earth 50 times over or more. That's an old statistic. That was a statistic from 20 years ago. Getting a bigger stick or a louder voice is not going to solve the problem at all. That's just going to continue to escalate the problem. But soft speech, a gentle heart, a humble heart, a gentle response, a thoughtful response will. Let's look at some examples of people with humble hearts. First of all, I think more than anyone else, Christ models for us what it means to be a humble person. Here's someone who came not as a royal being, as a royal deity, not as someone dressed in nice and expensive clothing, not as someone with great education, not as someone demanding an audience, not as someone haughty and prideful and arrogant, but someone who is gentle, calm, compassionate, someone who was slow to anger, someone who was thoughtful and deliberate as they acted, someone who was not controlled by their emotions and by their passions, but controlled them and mastered them. And that's our Savior. That's Christ. That's how He lived. Everything He did, and people began to follow Him by the thousands in droves, not because He had a loud voice and He was demanding attention and doing things to manipulate the media, even though there wasn't really media back then, but people that were gossipers and such that would carry on the heralding message. But quietly and calmly and gently, He taught people truth. And that's how we ought to be. I came across a great poem. I rarely read poems. That's not really my thing. But I know that it is more and more of poems or poetry is becoming more and more popular in culture. And so for those of you that enjoy a poem, I hope you will enjoy this. And I think it teaches a great message here as we look at Christ as a model for humility. Father, where shall I work today? And my love flowed warm and free. Then He pointed out a tiny spot and said, "Tend that for me." I answered quickly, "Oh no, not that. Why, no one would ever see. No matter how well my work was done, not that little place for me." And the word He spoke, it was not stern. He answered me tenderly, "Ah, little one, search that heart of thine. Art thou working for them or me? Nazareth was a little place, and so was Galilee." Of course, Jesus was from the area, from the town of Nazareth, from the region of Galilee. He came in a small way, and He changed the world forever. What person in the history of all creation has had more of an impact than Christ? The Bible is still the most read book in the world. If we want to make a difference, if we want our voice to be heard, we need to humble ourselves. We need to view everyone else as more important than we are. The fruit of pride is catastrophic. And it damages not only us, but everyone around us. Paul is another good example, and Paul grew in his humility as he got older. We see him in several cases struggling and making some haughty, kind of hot-headed decisions earlier on, but as he matured in his faith and as he matured on his missionary journeys, he changed. And Warren Wiersbe, who is a he's a theologian. He's written a number of commentaries for the scriptures. He points out that Paul makes several different statements throughout his epistles. The first one that comes from 1 Corinthians, he says, "I am the least of the apostles." Then Ephesians, he says, "I am the least of all the saints." Notice the change there. He considered him the least of the apostles. Now he considers himself the least of all the saints. And then in 1 Timothy, he says, "I'm the chief of all sinners." You know, somebody once said, humility is like underwear. We should have it on, but not let it show. And then there's some ads I've seen that maybe need to consider that statement there a little bit. But that's how humility should be. It should be something that we have on, but it's not in people's face. Because when we're humbly in someone's face, we're not really being humble. All right? When we're humble because we're trying to get ahead, because maybe, you know, if you're like me, you'll try to take this message and kind of manipulate it a little bit. And think, oh, okay, well, if I'm going to be humble, now I'm going to go out of my way to be quiet and gentle and to put others before me so that I can get my way and be heard and so on and so forth, all right? And seeing that doesn't work out, all right? That's like wearing your underwear on the outside, you know, or letting your pants hang down your knees or something, you know? All right, that's not really helpful or beneficial to us or for those around us. So I think Paul shows us a migration in his thinking and understanding of how we ought to see ourselves, especially in the body. You know, think of this in our immediate church family here, how important that is to humble ourselves, to see ourselves as servants of everyone else. That we would come here on Sunday afternoon, or we come Sunday night, Thursday night, Wednesday morning. I mean, we gather in a lot of different places and do a lot of different things every week as a body. And do we come with a heart of humility? Do we come to that place thinking, and are asking ourselves, how can I bless everyone else that's there? How can I serve them? How can I help them? Or do we come thinking, oh, I've got something to show everyone, or I'm going to be the one that says the special thing today, or I'm going to teach people something? Do we come with a haughty and an arrogant attitude? This last story that I want to look at is found in Matthew 25, and I would like for you to turn to it if you would, on your phone, or if you've got a Bible in the paper version. And I want to read this parable. I think this parable, while it does not deal directly with humility as the issue, pridefulness and humility is at the heart of this story. This is Matthew 25, beginning in verse 31. "When the Son of Man comes in His glory and all the angels with Him, He will sit on the throne of His glory, and all the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And He will put the sheep at His right hand and the goats at the left. And then the King will say to those at His right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by My Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' And then the righteous will answer Him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the King will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of My family, you did it to Me.' And then He will say to those at His left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from Me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels.'" See, the problem with pride is that we're often so blinded by it that we don't see it. We don't recognize it. We don't see the needs of people in front of us because our needs are so big. It's just like my hand right here over my face. I can't see you because my hand is so big in my face. And when we can't see past that, and we block the needs of other people out of our life, we lose everything. And I know that a lot of times, you know, I'm the kind of preacher that likes to preach encouraging messages where you come and you feel uplifted and encouraged and you walk away feeling stronger and ready to face the week. And I think that can happen today, but it's going to require us to go to that place of hardship first. It's going to have to cause us to recognize that we are arrogant and foolish and selfish, and we need to stop it. Because Christ is not glorified, He's dishonored in that. We hide from all of humanity the true Christ, the true person that He is. We damage ourselves. We wreck our potential to change the world, to help other people, to grow spiritually, to grow in ourselves. We hurt our family, we hurt our friends, we hurt the people that we work with, the people that we go to school with. Pridefulness and arrogance simply has no place in our life. If we've truly chosen Jesus, if we said in our heart, in our mind, I want to follow Him, I want to walk the path that He walked, that is a path of humility, a path of self-sacrifice. It's not a path of us getting what we want and demanding that other people do things for us or be what we want them to be or meet our needs. It demands that we humble ourselves and that we come low in the shadow of the cross. And it's at that place that God reaches down and to us in our miserable state, and He lifts us up. He exalts us. He pulls us up to the high place where He can use us. And He says that we are heirs, that we're sons and daughters. But we can't demand that of Him or of anyone else, because it's not our place. We don't have that power, that ability. We've not bought it. We don't own it. He does. He owns everything. He is all powerful and we are not. He sees everything and we do not. He is without sin and we are not. And so we have to humble ourselves and wait for Him to exalt us. Let's read that verse that we started with, and then we're going to close. 1 Peter 5:6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that He may exalt you. We come humbly before You this afternoon. Lord, I hope recognizing that we have chosen poorly in many areas of our life, that we've been arrogant and foolish. Lord, we just pause right now to humble ourselves in Your presence with the power of Your Spirit moving in our hearts and in our minds, that is transforming us, that is helping us to recognize the truth right now. God, I pray that everyone in this room, that every person listening to my voice, wherever they are right now, God, that they would be forever changed. That we would all choose to humble ourselves in Your sight, to bring ourselves low. God, like Paul right now, I feel like I am the chief of sinners. How dare I point the finger at anyone else or suggest or ask anyone else to be humble when I myself am arrogant and foolish. Yet, Lord, we find ourselves under the truth that none of us are righteous, not even one. And so, God, I pray that as we have a heart change today, I hope, that You would help us to see truth, that You would bind the enemy from blinding us. Lord, if there are decisions in our life that we need to change today because we realize that we've been walking on the wrong path, Lord, maybe there's some that we need to go to as we leave this place today and ask for repentance and to acknowledge the error of our way. God, I thank you for your mercy. I thank you that you do not abandon us when we sin, when we fall short of your standard of righteousness. God, that your grace permeates every sin, every evil deed. Lord, I rejoice in that grace and claim it today and pray that you would change each of us. In Jesus' name, amen.